center. Today is a beginning day. Yeah, this is a wonderful memorial day. And thank you very much also for inviting me, for giving me a chance to present my recent research concerning the first principle base field method for predicting microstructures of arrays. Okay, this is the title of today's talk. And this talk is not only for my research, but also the in collaboration with Dr. Ryoji Sahara at the National Institute for Materials Science, NIMS, Japan, and Dr. Riichi Kuwahara, Dassault Systems. This is a software company worldwide in France, but his office is Tokyo, Japan. And Dr. Subhashprata Bhattacharya, she was my earlier postdoc, but now she is staff of Birla Institute of Technology and Science, BITS, Pilani, Goa in India. And finally, the Dr. Tinu Pham, she is also my former postdoc, and she's now working in JST and at Yokohama National University. Okay, I would like to the contents of the today talk is as follows. The first principle calculation for prologue, solid phases for introduction, Lattice Monte Carlo method based on first principles, connection to first principle phase field method, mechanical properties in finite element method, other alloys in first principle phase field method, so solutions from first principle calculation, comparison with conventional phase field method, summary and future prospects. Okay, so then I will proceed to the first section, first principle calculation for prologue. And first principle calculation is, as you know, calculation to simulate natural phenomena according to basic physical principles, in particular quantum mechanics, without any empirical parameter. However, there are several limitations of using first principle calculations. First of all, there is a special size limit. The first principle calculation is mostly limited to the size of 1 nanometer scale. And if we want to simulate larger scale beyond this 1 nanometer, we have to use coarse graining technique or multi-scale simulation techniques. Okay. And in addition to this size limitation, the density function theory, DFT, which is used for most of the fields recently. Many, many people are using density function theory, but this theory is limited to the ground state properties only. Okay, in order to study the excited states of electronic states, it's necessary to go beyond density function theory. People can use quantum chemistry methods such as a configuration interaction, CI, or coupled cluster theory, CC, or alternatively, one can use the solid state physics method, such as a quasi particle Green's function method, like GW method. And this is what Suriya-san introduced kindly, and the book written by myself and Professor K-1 Eswarjani and Professor Yoshiki Kawase. And this book was first written, published in 1999, but recent progress was not covered in this first edition. And then we published recently, second edition in 2018. Okay, and let's, sorry, it's okay. This is some of our recent work. Extensive first principle molecular dynamics study on lithium encapsulation into C60 and its experimental conformation. This is collaborated with Dr. Adicha Manjanath. I saw he is attending this webinar, the opening session at least, and Professor Yoshi Kawase and all the other person are experimenters. And next, my recent research is photo energy conversion efficiency of methyl ammonium, lead iodide plus C60 heterojunction perovskite solar cells from first principles. This is done by Professor Kianfui Chu, Dr. Riichi Kuwahara, and myself. And this is recently published in Materials Advances. Okay, and C60 is put on top of the perovskite surface, and these are the resulting quantum orbitals and quantum energy levels. And from this information, we succeeded in obtaining photo energy convergence efficiency as a function of the adsorption site. According to our calculation, the among many possible adsorption site above iodine site is the top. Energy convergence efficiency is almost 19 or more than 19%. We obtained this result recently. And this is an example of the the excited state calculation using Tombow. And this is a case of the X-ray emission spectroscopy calculation. As you know, the XPS, X-ray photo emission spectroscopy, the X-ray photon is absorbed and the core level, one electron is emitted to the vacuum level and one core, deep core hole is created in this process. And what is the difference between XPS and XAS? And XAS is something like the photo absorption process, which means that also the X-ray photon is absorbed, but in this case, the deep core level electron is excited not to the vacuum level, but to the conduction band. So it remains still in the material and it creates a bound state called exciton, core exciton. Okay, so this is a XAS process. What is XES? XES is the second process after the XPS process. After the XPS process, deep core hole is created. And to fill this deep core hole, one of the electrons at the valence band falls down to fill this deep core hole. And simultaneously, one X-ray photon is emitted from this material. Okay, this is called the X-ray emission spectroscopy. So this in this calculation, you see the initial state is the highly excited state, which has the deep core hole. Okay, this is a highly excited state. So we should tug on this highly excited state as the initial state. Okay, but we know that the many body perturbation theory, especially the quasi-particle theory, can be applied to the initially excited states also. So from this idea, we can simply apply the GW plus beta theta equation approach to this problem. Okay, this is the experimental X-ray emission spectrum, which has a 5 peaks like that. And this is a case of methanol. And this is our calculated result. This also has 5 peaks. The peak position is slightly different, but almost the same, because the absolute value is very large, 276 electron volt. Therefore, the deviation from the experimental value is very small, less than 0.5 percentage or something. Okay, so with this accuracy, we succeeded reproducing to the X-ray emission spectrum, experimental X-ray emission spectra, without using any empirical parameter. Okay, these are our recent calculation result. And now I want to introduce something to the arrows. First of all, I'd like to introduce you solid phases. As you know, there are many various crystal structures, such as body center cubic, face centered cubic, hexagonal cross packed, as well as orthorhombic, tetragonal, rhombohedral, many crystal structures are there. Okay. And this is copied from Wikipedia, and this is well known periodic table, but for the crystal structure. Okay. Titanium has a HCP, most stable structure. Iron has BCC, nickel, copper, okay, and silver, gold, and lead is also FCC, okay, and tin is tetragonal, and all other element has their own preferable crystal structures, okay, like that. And this is an example of the phases. Okay, in the case of one component, for example, iron, pure iron case. As you know, iron, the BCC phase is most stable at zero temperature. But at high temperature, gamma FCC phase becomes more stable. And this is a comparison between two phases, free energy. And this is a BCC alpha phase free energy, red one. And this blue one is a FCC gamma phase free energy. And there is a crossover intersection at certain temperature. And this temperature is corresponding to the phase transformation temperature. And because in the two components case, in the case of solder, for example, this is a lead tin alloy, binary alloy. And in this case, alpha phase is mostly composed of the lead, and beta phase is mostly composed of tin. And these are the free energy curve at certain temperature T, and you can draw the common tangent in between. And the contact points corresponds to the phase boundary at this temperature, T, okay? And this is a temperature phase diagram versus composition. Horizontal axis is a composition the same as the lower panel. Okay, and leftward, from the leftward, this is a pure alpha phase, and this alpha phase. And from the rightward, from this contact point, is the pure beta phase. But in between these contact points, the coexistence phase between alpha and beta, okay? The similar behavior occurs in the upper part also. This is totally liquid phase, but in between there is a liquid plus alpha phase here in this region and liquid plus beta phase, coexistence phase in this region. And this is a eutectic point, okay? Because this eutectic point is rather lower compared to the other temperatures. That's why the lead tin alloy is used as solder. Okay, this is melt at the lower temperatures. Okay. Okay, in this kind of thing, we will discuss. Okay, the good target for non-parameter large-scale simulation is alloys. Okay, alloys are durable materials made up of two or more materials, such as solder, lead tin, stainless steel, iron chromium, iron chromium nickel, fluorine silver, copper nickel zinc, geraldine, aluminum copper magnesium. The current high cost and design limitations of traditional alloy manufacturing processes have driven the need to create more efficient design methods. So these are the example of microstructure of alloys. The microstructures are the visible by microscope or scanning electron microscope, SEM. And these are the example of gold silver alloy, aluminum silicon magnesium alloy, aluminum silicon copper alloy. And all these microstructures consist of precipitates, grain boundaries, dislocations, cracks, greatly influences physical properties such as strength, ductility, plasticity, toughness, heat, corrosion, wear and tear resistances. One key challenge is to accurately predict microstructures of alloys from past principles. This is another example of iron platinum alloy cluster. In this case, there are many vast number of fine particles. Particle size is like that, several nanometers size. Okay. This is an earlier experiment by Professor Ohno's group in NIMS, and this is the summary of the experimental result. We will discuss later this diagram. Okay, and so simulation technique, the first principle calculation can handle this spatial size, 0.3 nanometer to 3 nanometer. And the classical molecular dynamics can handle 3 nanometer to 0.3 micrometer. Or Lattice Monte Carlo simulation can handle the same size. But beyond this size, we have to use the coarse grain method, such as the phase field method or finite element method. For the time scale, the first principle calculation can handle 1 femsecond to 10 picosecond, but classical molecular dynamics can handle 100 picosecond to 1 microsecond. Lattice Monte Carlo can handle 10 microsecond to 100 millisecond. But phase field method or finite element method can handle 1 second to 100 hours. Okay, this very long scale simulation can be possible if we use this technique. So first, I'd like to show some example of Lattice Monte Carlo method based on first principles. First, we have to use cluster expansion method. Colony-Williams paper is very famous, and we use a tetrahedron approximation proposed by this person. And tetrahedron is this four lattice sites, including a unit cell. We use this unit cell And we use cluster expansion with atomic vacancies, which was proposed by in this paper. And in this case, we use this method, iron platinum alloys clusters. And this is total energy expanded in terms of the spin variables like that. If spin is plus one, it means this is iron atom. If spin is minus one, this means platinum atom. And if it is zero, it is vacancy. And we can expand the total energy in this way. But if we fix all the atoms at the lattice point, the result is not very good because atomic displacement at the lattice points are very important to discuss the finite temperature behavior. So we have to eliminate the degrees of freedom shorter than the lattice constant. So how to do it? We propose to use the potential renormalization theory, which we equalize the partition function of the potential energy calculated by the fully first principle calculation and integrate the Boltzmann weight in this way and calculate the partition function. But this is too heavy. So we have to replace this partition function in terms of the lattice variables, this spin variables. Okay, this spin variables dependent local free energy is first calculated by using the equality. We set equal to this to formula and from this equation, we deduce this local free energy. So this is the necessary step to eliminate the degrees of freedom shorter than the lattice constant. In this way, myself and Sahara-san and Kawazoe-sensei earlier applied this method to copper gold alloy, silicon crystals or melt, and the summer expansion of silicon crystal like that. This is a free energy curve and the minimum point is shifted when the temperature is increased, okay, up to lower. And in this case, copper aluminum alloy, there is a phase transformation between solid solution lambda phase and the intermetallic phase, regular phase. As an intermetallic regular phase, L10 phase is in the 50-50 concentration case, and L12 intermetallics appears in the around the copper three copper three gold or copper gold three alloy stoichiometry. But not restricted to the stoichiometric composition, but also the surrounding or the stoichiometric composition can be handled with this intermetallic regular phases. Okay, and in this case, we use the embedded atom potential instead of the first principle calculation because of the heaviness, and we applied the potential renormalization theory. That's not our solution, and we obtain this result. Okay, but if we want to apply the first principle calculation, this full renormalization is very heavy. Therefore, we simplify the step to original two-step renormalization. Can be simplified to the one-step renormalization. In this case, we can apply the first principle calculation. And in this case, the surrounding atoms are fixed at the lattice point, and only the center atom is moved. This mesh point as the selecting point, and all these points, we calculate the total energy, and we calculate this local trace, okay, and to obtain the free energy difference. Okay, this is our strategy to introduce linearization. And to do that, we use a bus code in that moment, and we use this supercell. And explicitly, we use this wedge corner because we can use symmetry. So only this wedge points are needed for the calculation in the FCC case, for example, right? And these are the resulting total free energies. Okay, this is a case without vacancies. This is a case with one vacancy. This is with two vacancies. This is only one atom exists inside the tetrahedron unit cell. Okay. All this information are used to perform the Monte Carlo simulation. This is a case where iron platinum cluster aggregation is simulated by the Lattice Monte Carlo simulation. And this is the final result of the iron platinum alloy cluster is Lattice Monte Carlo simulation. This diameter is 16.5 nanometer, and you can see L10 order here. Because this is a transparent view, and green plus corresponds to platinum, and the diamond corresponds to iron. And because of transparent view, if iron platinum are alternating ordered, and this corresponds to L10 order. But in this case, this is superposed, and iron and platinum is superposed, and this dark symbol are not the ordered part, okay? And even if this diameter, the upper part and lower part is disordered, only the in between, the bulk part is ordered. But this part, surface part is disordered. This is a top view. And this is our result of the order parameter versus the diameter of the cluster. And as this experiment suggests, around 2 nanometer, the order parameter abruptly falls down and order parameter becomes zero in between 0 to 2 nanometer. Okay, so there is a threshold of the diameter size of the cluster where the L10 order exists. Okay, and this is a bulk iron platinum case, and this is also the Lattice Monte Carlo simulation. This is without linearization, and this is a result of the with linearization. And this is almost all the space achieved in 1800 Kelvin. And this is the final result. Long range order is plotted versus temperature. And because this is a long range order quenched from disordered space, therefore only the order is appeared at certain temperature. And if we quench rapidly to the lower temperature, because of the freeze of the atomic diffusion, there is no long range order generation. Okay, so this is a Monte Carlo result. And we want to connect this approach to the first principle phase field method. Phase field modeling is, as you know, is to treat microstructure as continuous field variables, named as order parameter phi, and the free energy f of the function of phi is required. The free energy is usually assumed in a polynomial Ginzburg lambda form like that. This is a quadratic polynomial form, a over 2 pi to squared, b over 4 pi to the fourth, c over 2 gradient pi to the fourth second, okay? And this is integrated to the whole space. Okay, this is a free energy expression, and time evolution equation is derived in two different ways. One is for the conserved order parameter case. This is called the Kahn-Hilliard equation. In this case, the time derivative of the order parameter is proportional to the divergence of the m multiple of the gradient of the functional derivative of the free energy with respect to the order parameter. Okay, this form is used for the conserved field order parameter. And on the other hand, if we use the non-conserved order parameter field, we should use Allan-Kahn equation like that. This is much simpler than the previous one. This is simply the order parameter derivative with respect to time is proportional to the functional derivative of the free energy with respect to the order parameter itself. Okay, but in our approach, we use Kahn-Hilliard equation, this conserved field approach. Okay, previous phase field modeling is like that. In the case of nickel aluminum alloy with CALFAD and CVM. CVM is a cluster variation method, a theoretical method to treat the cluster expansion theory. And CALFAD is semi-empirical approach to reproduce the phase diagram. And this is a combined simulation for the nickel aluminum alloy. And these are the initial pattern, and this is the final pattern. And phase field modeling can be applied also for the external, under the external load. Tensor force is applied in this direction, and the sample is elongated in this direction. And this deformation can be also treated by the phase field model. But the problem of the previous phase field modeling is they are purely empirical approach, which requires some dynamic parameters. Concerning the nickel aluminum alloy, this is high strength and toughness alloy, and the good corrosion and heat resistance. And there are many industrial applications, such as aerospace industry application, such as turbine disk and the engine brake, etc. Okay, the most important concentration is nickel 83%. Atomic percent case, weight percent case. And this is called the nickel aluminum super, and which causes this kind of microstructures. Okay, this kind of microstructures. These are the experimental views. And these alloys can be used as a high temperature path as a nickel aluminum super alloy in this jet engine. But the phase field simulation result is something like that. You can say this result is similar to that one, but if you compare in detail, the shape is slightly different between each other because these are all cuboidal form. The edge is very sharp, but here, edge is very round, okay? The shape is similar, but not exactly the same. Okay, this is a problem of the previous phase field simulation using the empirical parameters. Okay. Okay, so lack of the bridge connecting fast principle calculation to phase field modeling is a problem. So we have to construct a fast principle phase field method without any parameter to reproduce experiments, doing accurate coarse graining from fast principles, and deriving a time evolution equation for the local atomic composition as a conserved field value. Okay, this is our aim. And what we learned so far is lattice Montecarlo simulation is successful. We use cluster expansion, including atomic vacancies, potential renormalization theory, and all these techniques, first principle calculations is applicable. And therefore, the result is predictable without empirical parameter. But instead, phase field simulation needs coarse grained parameters as empirical thermodynamic inputs to reproduce experimental microstructures. Thus, phase field simulation is non-predictable and unreliable, unfortunately. Okay, so our strategy is to use the same method as the lattice Montecarlo simulation to the first principles phase field simulation. This is a completely new approach based on our idea. Okay, I would like to introduce this method. So this paper was first published by Dr. Subhashvarata Bhattacharya, Dr. Sahara Ryoji, and myself in Nature Communications in 2019, 2 years ago, for the nickel aluminum calculations. And as I explained to you for the lattice Montecarlo simulation, we use the same method as that. We use a cluster expansion for the unit cell. We divide the space into the fine grid, and finally we use a unit cell, including just several atoms inside. And inside this unit cell, we use a potential renormalization technique. And because of this technique, this lattice point is not written in a single point, but this is this point has the distribution around the lattice point. Okay, this is written in this squares and these shapes. Okay, and this is a case of the FCC lattice. This is a case of the BCC lattice. This is a case of the trigonal lattice case. And all this information can be handled within the cluster expansion method. And we can apply first principle method, therefore no parameters. But in this case, local free energy is not a continuous function, but becomes a step function of the local composition. So in order to define the local composition, we discretize the composition variables, phi of nickel, phi of aluminum, as 0 to 1 values for 0, and 1 to 2 for 1, 2 to 3, 2 for 2, 2 3 to 4 for 3, 4 to 5 for 4, 5 to 6 for 5 atoms inside the unit cell. Okay, because the number of atoms inside the unit cell is an integer number, so we have to discretize this concentration number. Okay, and this free energy becomes therefore stepwise like that. In between integer to next integer, the the free energy has a flat plateau. Okay, and this is a two-dimensional map of the free energy, local free energy. The horizontal axis is nickel concentration, and the vertical axis is aluminum concentration, and each square corresponds to each composition. And inside each square, the free energy value is constant. Okay, but outside this large square, we use the polynomial continuous function as usual. Okay, this is the derivation of the Kahn-Hilliard equation we explained earlier. But how to derive this Kahn-Hilliard equation is as follows. We first define the chemical potential as a derivative of the free energy with respect to the composition. But the interface energy derivative term should be added to the chemical potential. And this is a continuity equation between the composition and the mass flux. Okay. And the mass flux is defined as a minus of the mobility times the gradient of the chemical potential. And combine all these three equations, we can derive this Kahn-Hilliard equation. This is very famous and usually used for the usual phase field simulation for the conserved order parameter. But in our case, chemical potential cannot be calculated by this derivative because the free energy is a step function, not a continuous function. So this derivative cannot be evaluated easily. Therefore, we instead use this finite difference. But according to the original definition of the chemical potential, the chemical potential should be defined as the one atom difference of the free energies. Okay, this corresponds to that definition. Therefore, we think this definition is more suitable to the Kahn-Hilliard equation from the original definition. Okay, so we replace everywhere this derivative with this finite difference, like that. Okay, then we apply first principle calculation, potential renormalization technique, cluster expansion theory, and do the same thing as the usual phase field simulation. We can do the first principle phase field simulation like this. This is the result. And this is an experimental nickel aluminum phase diagram. And there are several regions in the phase diagram. We fix the temperature at 1027 Celsius. Centigrade. This is region one. Region one, we obtain this microstructures. And region two, this is nickel two, aluminum three. This is a homogeneous phase. We have the homogeneous result as well. And this is the region three. Is also homogeneous, okay. And this is nickel aluminum phase, okay. The equi-atomic composition phase, almost equi-atomic. But slightly, if the composition is slightly different, this kind of precipitation appears within this region, okay. And region five, we have this, microstructures, and region six is, this is a gamma dash phase. This is nickel three aluminum stoichiometric composition. Therefore, this is homogeneous, totally homogeneous. And outside this region, region eight is almost homogeneous, but there is some distribution of the different composition like this, gradual change exists in this region. But this is called gamma phase. And this region is called gamma dash phase. And this in between region 7 is the coexistence between gamma and gamma dash, gamma prime phase. These precipitates appears in this region 7. Okay, this region 7 is most important because this is used for the jet engine turbine application. Okay, the nickel alumina superalloy is in this region. This is a case of nickel 78%. This is a case of nickel 84%. And in the case of 78%, this is the initial pattern, and this is the intermediate pattern, and final pattern becomes like that. And this is again initial pattern for the nickel 82% case. And this is intermediate pattern, and this is the final pattern. After final pattern, even if we increase the time, this pattern doesn't change anymore. Okay, this is, therefore this is a stable microstructure. Okay, if we compare this final pattern with the experiment, the result is they resemble each other because this is not round. This is sharp edge appears here like that. This old edge as a sharp edge appears, okay, like this edge. Okay, this is a distinguished, this result is distinguished from the previous phase field method. Previous phase field method is all the shape is round, okay, but this result is different. More resemble to the experimental pattern. Okay, in this method, not only the composition, but also we can simultaneously obtain local free energy distribution like this, and take the derivative of the local free energy, we can draw the local stress distribution like this. And from this figure, we can identify that local stress is concentrated at the periphery site of the each precipitate. And there are several merits of the first principle phase field method. This is so to say the tolerance behavior, we can say, because there is no requirement for the structural information. Only the final energy information is used for the phase field model. We don't use any structural information, which means the difference between the competitive atomic geometries existing, for example, FCC and BCC of iron is not certain. Even if it is not certain, it is okay. Use either one of them. Yes, just simply use that. This is okay because energy difference is anyway very small. Therefore, even if we use a long information, longer energy for the long geometry, it's okay because the difference is very small. We don't use the structure information. In the same way, HCP and BCC of titanium is not necessarily be distinguished. Okay, this change cannot and doesn't affect the result. The local free energy is the step function of the composition is also the another merit. The chemical potential is difference of the local free energy. Therefore, we succeeded in reproducing this experimental microstructures. And final stationary pattern does not depend on mobility because the final structure doesn't anymore changes in time. And the interfacial energy coefficient can be set arbitrarily by rescaling the length scale or set at a certain value expected by experimental or theoretical study. But most easily, it can be set arbitrarily as a parameter. But this is, as you know, this is a scaling parameter, not the empirical parameter. For this scaling parameter, you can afterwards compare with the experimental pattern and resulting pattern, and you can determine the size of the units, the size of the simulation cell. Okay, this is a way to avoid the very hard determination by first calculation the interfacial energy. Okay, you can do that. But even though the free energy calculation, the linearization step is very hard, it requires many, many first principle calculations on the mesh points, grid points, in the fine grid points inside the unit cell. Okay. So in order to avoid manual submission of the first principle calculations many, many times, we provided the automatic submission protocol by using pipeline pilot protocol supported by the DASO system. So if you have a license of the pipeline pilot, please use that. We can distribute to the users. Okay, please feel free to contact us in that case. Okay, the calculation uses CASTEP for the first calculation, and this submission protocol can be applicable to arbitrary ternary arrays. Okay, then I would briefly explain the mechanical properties in connection to finite element method. This is a special distribution of von Mises stress. This is the final result of the FPPF result at 82% nickel case. And this result is inserted to the FEM, finite element method program, ABACUS, supported by DASO system. We use this program, and this has the same shape, okay? As you see, this has the same shape, located slightly different, but this is because of the von Mises stress distribution, not the nickel concentration distribution. And in order to calculate this von Mises stress, we put input parameters like that. We input only four parameters: pure nickel, Young modulus, and Poisson's ratio. And nickel 3 aluminum pure phase. This is a stoichiometric single crystal phase. We can calculate from ab initio Young modulus and Poisson's ratio as well. And these are the first principle calculated data. And we simply interpolate these two values inside the ABACUS program, FEM program. This can be done automatically. And only four inputs are required to reproduce this von Mises stress, okay? And this is a case where we pull up the upper side of this body by applying tensile stress. And there is a very strong strain appeared in this region. And this is the original phase field pattern. And after some time, there is a crack here. And the crack is generated here, and it propagates, it propagate in the leftward, and after that, the body is totally broken, okay, because of the tensile stress we are putting up the body upward, this sample, okay. In this way, we can simulate the crack generation and propagation by connecting the phase field model to the finite element method. Okay, other is for first method. Basically, method is as follows. This is a case of ternary alloys case, and this is titan 64 alloy, 90 weight percent titanium, 6 weight percent aluminum, 4 weight percent vanadium. And the left hand side, two panels are first principle phase field result, and right two panels are experimental figures, patterns. And as you see, the above one is a vanadium concentration, and lower panels are aluminum concentrations. The right one is experimental, the left one is theoretical. And those are very quite dissimilar to each other. Okay, these red spots are this is a beta phase, and in between this blue phase is alpha phase, and the alpha beta mixture appears in this region. Okay, this makes this alloy very strong. Okay, this structure is very important. And next example is titanium nickel phase diagram. In this case, we perform phase field simulation at 927 Celsius. And we mainly consider the equi-atomic composition region, like in this region. And when the nickel atomic percent is slightly less than the 50%, we obtain this kind of pattern, which has nickel two, titanium two nickel precipitate appears here. And all the rest part is a titanium nickel single crystal. Okay. This is quite similar to the experimental data, which is measured by the at 900 Celsius using self-propagating high temperature synthesis. And this black part is titanium 2 nickel precipitates, as well as this cuboidal precipitates. Right? And this is a case of platinum titanium phase diagram. And in this case, we mostly concentrate on the titanium rich phases here, around here, when the platinum concentration is very small. Okay, the weight percent of platinum is around 20. Okay, that is somewhere here. We concentrate this region. Okay, in this region, left-hand side is our calculation result, and right-hand side is an experimental result. And this lamella-like structure is similar to this lamella structure. Okay, if we magnify, this structure is very quite dissimilar to this structure. Okay, this is a case where platinum is 5 weight percent, small platinum. And this is a case where the 10 weight percent platinum, this is the experimental pattern. And again, this is our pattern is dissimilar to this pattern. Okay, and when the platinum concentration is increased to 15 weight percent, this yellow precipitate appears first, and this corresponds to this precipitate experimental. Okay, this yellow pattern corresponds to this precipitate experimentally also precipitates. It appears at 15 weight percent platinum. And this precipitates increase when platinum concentration increased to 20 weight percent. As you know, you you can compare this shape as compared with this one, this sample to each other. Okay, you can compare either this one with that. Okay, in this way, we succeed in reproduce the precious metal alloy case. We reproduce the microstructure. And the next topic is the solid solution from first principle calculation. This is our recent result. How to treat solid solutions? We so far tackled this only for the two-phase coexistence or precipitates only. But in the case of solid solution, the situation is a little bit different. Okay, this is a case of titanium vanadium alloy. And at high temperatures, temperature above 882 centigrade, okay, and there is an all proportional solid solution phase, beta, called beta. Okay, beta is a BCC based phase. In this case, pure titanium also has a BCC phase because the titanium at low temperature, titanium, of course, prefers HCP phase, but at certain temperature above 882 Celsius, the BCC phase is more stable compared to the HCP phase. Therefore, in all regions in the phase diagram, the beta, namely BCC-based random solution, solid solution, is appearing in this region everywhere. Okay. So how to treat this solid solution phase? But below this line, alpha plus beta coexistence phase appears. So there is a phase transformation between a certain temperature. So how to treat that? So first, we calculate the first principle phase field method and calculate the stoichiometric local free energies of titanium vanadium alloys. And this is a case of titanium N, vanadium N minus, 4 minus N. And this is 0, 1, 2, 4, 3, 4 for N. The value Ln, okay, and this energy curve, energy plot, is surprisingly very close to the linear line. Linear line is just interpolate between the two extremal values, E beta titanium, E beta vanadium. Of course, in this case, we assume always BCC lattice, okay, in this case. In this case, the interpolated straight line is very close to the real local free energies. This is very characteristic compared to, for example, the nickel aluminum alloy. In this case, the real plot is far off from the straight line. In this case, linear dependence doesn't exist. But in this case, linear dependency, we can see linear dependency. In this case, we can expect the all proportional solid solution for titanium vanadium. But for nickel aluminum, because this is far off from the linear dependency, therefore nickel aluminum doesn't follow the solid solution behavior. We can say that. So this is the first screen of the first principle method, and the BCC beta solid solution phase is therefore the free energy can be well approximated by the simple interpolation between two extremal local free energies like that. But in the case of the coexistence of HTP alpha and BCC beta phase, in order to apply our method to this region, we have to treat alpha plus beta coexistence phase. In this case, alpha phase is a pure HTP phase. Okay, therefore, we have to addition the alpha phase in the free energy. So X of the total four composition is the alpha titanium phase, we assume. And of course, the energy of the alpha titanium is lower than the beta titanium. This is most stable phase at low temperatures, okay? And in this case, we slightly change by introducing this X, and we write the free energy in this way. And most stable composition for X can be determined by taking the derivative of this free energy as a function of X and put it equal to zero. This is a condition to the extreme. I forgot to explain that this interfacial energy. Additionally, we have to introduce this interfacial energy. This D is a parameter, but this interfacial energy is needed because this is a two-phase coexistence between HTP alpha phase and BCC beta phase. There is an interface. Therefore, we have to introduce additional interfacial energy. So we know the dependence of the X to the five to the third, okay? And this is proportional constant. We simply add this one. And we take the derivative and set equal to zero, and we obtain this maximum value for X. And this is the obtained value for X and maximum. Okay, then we can construct the continuous phase field model in this way. This is the original Kahn-Hilliard equation. And in this case, the chemical potential is again the finite difference of the free energy. And free energy in this case is the function of N of N and X, but X is set at the Xm, X maximum, okay? And this free energy is used for this function, and this function is looked like that. This is not a 2D map. This is just a 1D function, okay, one-dimensional function. So we perform this new reconstructed continuous phase period simulation, and this is a result of our simulation. And this is almost all homogeneous, but somewhere the composition is slightly different from the other part. This is, you can see this is a little bit darker from the other part. Okay, there is a slight concentration distribution. Okay, these are the two phase coexistence phase. This is the initial configuration, and these are the final, all final. And in order to compare with the purely random phase, we have to prepare as a purely random configuration. To do that, we use a special quasi-random structure, SQS model, proposed by Zünger group in 1990. And we use a 4x4x4 cubic BCC cell, including 128 atoms inside the unit cell. And we prepared 15 different compositions like this. And in order to calculate the accurate free energy, we should add mixing entropy as well. this is a form of the mixing entropy, because this is a purely random phase. Mixing entropy is very important to be added to this phase. And this is a final comparison between the random phase generated by the SQS model, and this is a continuous BPF model result, and we compare the result at zero temperature and 1,300 Kelvin high temperature. And in the case of zero temperature, FPPF two-phase coexistence is more stable, more favorable. Lead is more below or to the blue spot. But at the higher temperatures, blue spots, the random phase is more stable, more lower energy, has lower energy compared to the FPPF coexistence phase. So in this energy comparison, we can conclude that at the higher temperature, we have the all proportional solid solution beta phase, like this random phase created by the SQS model. But below a certain temperature, at least at zero temperature, we obtain alpha plus beta coexistence FPPF phase. All right. So criterion for solid solution phase is to calculate local free energy in the FPPF method, check its linearity on the composition ratio. If it is linear, then do the following. Otherwise, the system is not a solid solution, we can conclude. In the linear case, we have to perform first principle supercell calculation for random configuration using the SQS model and perform original or continuous FPPF simulation and compare the resulting free energies, and we can judge if the solution is the alloy is solid solution or the two-phase coexistence. Okay, so this is almost a final slide. Comparison between conventional and present phase field method. This is a conventional method. Free energy is continuous and empirical, and we usually use the Ginzburg-Randolph FIFO model for the free energy. But for the present model, we use a step function, and which is produced by the cluster expansion, potential renormalization, and first principle calculations. And chemical potential is usually the derivative of the free energy, but we use a finite difference of the free energy. And the elastic energy, anisotropic energy, entropy are necessary in the conventional method, but in the present method, unnecessary, except for the mixing entropy for the purely random phase. Okay. And comparison between conventional and the phase field method is continued like that. The empirical parameter necessary in the conventional method, but present method is necessary, unnecessary. Experimental data necessary, but present method unnecessary. Prediction of unknown materials is impossible in the conventional method, but our method is possible. Okay, this is summary. We are able to predict array microstructures by using the first principle phase field method without using any empirical thermodynamic parameter. This procedure predicts the microstructure of alloys based on the fundamental laws of physics alone, first principle calculations alone. This is contrary to empirical modeling or predictions based on experiments or previous observations. Using this method, we have conducted various alloy simulations at high temperatures. We can connect the first principle phase field FPPF method to finite element method FEM to simulate mechanical properties. And these are the future prospects. The establishment of the first principle phase field method as a large-scale simulation technique without empirical parameters is our aim. And in order to achieve that, we have to further treat the complex crystal structures, multi-component alloys, polycrystals, order disorder, phase transformation, etc., and the combination with finite element methods, FEM, has been partially succeeded, but the prediction of mechanical properties of alloys and first principle simulation of fracture is left for the future study. This is the all of my presentation, and thank you very much for your kind attention.